All right, hello fellow mapmakers. Welcome to today's live mapmaking session. I'm Ralf Schemann of ProFantasy Software, and I'm going to show you a bit how to create a dungeon with a connecting cave in a dungeon campaign cartographer with tools from Dungeon Designer. And I'll be using the Simple Set 4 Dungeons of Schley style for the map. But everything can be done just with the basic program as well. I'm just using some other sets I've been using already. And let's see how this goes. As usual, I will be answering questions, taking a few breaks and answering questions during the video. So if you have any questions, post them in the chat, and Sue will collect them and forward them once to me that I might be able to answer. Again, I'll be doing some very basic map work, and I'm going to be explaining some of the interface of Campaign Cartographer for those who haven't used it much before, and hope those who are very familiar with it will forgive me for that. So what's the topic of today's map-making session? It's a dungeon and a cave, and to connect that a bit to previous videos, I want to continue a structure in a location we've been using before. Just last session we did the perspectives isometric version of the Temple of Isis floor plan, and the floor plan itself was done the week before. And we just, while mapping, I introduced that one stair down to a cellar or a crypt below the temple, here in the upper right of the floor plan. And I'm going to take that and I'll create a lower level for the temple from that idea and connect that to a cave during this video. So let's see, what do we need for that? We need a new map. So I'm going up to the file toolbar at the top with all the icons for new maps, loading and saving maps, printing, as well as all the shortcuts to the different menus for the different add-ons for Campaign Cartographer. So I'm going to click the new map icon, which brings up the new drawing wizard, where we first choose a map type we want to draw, and as mentioned, we are going to do a dungeon. So click next, and then I get the large list of different map styles to choose from. And as I said, I was going to do a Dungeon of Slay type dungeon. I'm sticking with the Imperial templates, meaning using feet and inches, as opposed to a metric template. That's just because we started out with that. I'm going to click Next, and then I can set the size of the drawing area. Our default map size is always 1,000 by 800, but I'm going to do something smaller here. Otherwise, it's just going to be a tiny section of the overall map. So let's say I'm going with 120 feet by 90 feet as the drawing area. I could put in a map title and copyright notice at this point, but I'm not going to bother. I can always do that later. But I'm going to click Next, and I want to choose a different map background. You see, the default background for the map style is a grass and dirt bitmap texture. But since I want to do something underground, I thought a grassy area outside my walls wouldn't be very appropriate. So instead, I'm going to choose a natural stone bitmap texture. And I've got several here, and I like my background to be fairly dark. So I'm going to choose the second darkest one from the list, natural stone 4. And that's enough for what I need to do setting up the map, so I'm going to click Finish and save the map as Temple of Isis Underground. And here's my basic map. Now, for a dungeon layout, I often like to put on a grid as the first thing I'm doing, because that helps me laying out the rooms and corridors. So I'm gonna go up to the menu, click on draw, and do hex or square overlay. That gives me my grid, and I'm already set to a square grid, which I want, but I want a 5-foot grid, not a 10-foot grid, and I'm unchecking any labels. Setting the snap grid here is good, because that means the snap grid where my mouse clicks go will be the same as the visual grid. And then I'm just go apply, and there's my grid on the map. Seeing here that actually, because of the slightly outside the 90 feet, my grid is a bit beyond the map border. And to fix that, I'm just going to show you a little, do this a little bit differently. First, I'm just going to do an undo and going to do the grid again. And instead of just clicking apply, I'm going to select points. This is when you want the grid only on part of your map or have an issue like this. Click select points. Then I'm going to go for the left, lower left corner up to the upper right corner. And there's my grid exactly where I want it to be. Next up, I'm going to turn on sheet effects because I want to see the map exactly how it looks right from the start while I'm drawing. And for that, I'm going up to the properties bar, which shows me which sheet I'm on, which layers I'm drawing on, and so on. I'm going to click on the sheets and effects indicator. That's the one that starts with S here. And I'm going to activate sheet effects. Okay. And there's my grid a little softened out, so it's not quite as strong on the map. So what do we need? We need a crypt or larger room below the temple where the stairwell from the ground floor leads to. I'm going to start with that on the left of the drawing area. I'm then going to continue with the cave to the right. Just my first few thoughts about the layout. And this is where I'm looking at is the drawing area, the big one where my map actually is. So I'm going to go over to the left toolbar, and where my tools for the style of type of map I'm using are located, from rooms and corridors to walls, different terrain drawing tools, down to options to edit stuff and move and copy stuff around. But I'm interested in the topmost buttons at the moment because I want to start by drawing a room. That's my room drawing tool here, which brings the Add Room dialog, where I can set the floor background and the wall background, or wall texture for my dungeon. I'm going to stick with the ones that I've set yesterday. Actually, it's the floor background is cobbles, which is probably not perhaps not quite adequate for a dungeon floor. So let's see whether we've got some paving, we've got the natural stone, and we've got some paving type textures here. Let's go with the gray paving, which that looks very nice for a dungeon. But the for the walls, brick gray sounds like a good type of wall. We've got a third option, the foreground here, but we're going to leave that. We can put another type of texture on that. For example, we could go with a partial texture, like a dirt with holes in it, which will cover part of the floor with dust or dirt. But I'm gonna leave that for the cave for the moment. So I'm gonna just use the Add Room. And now I can draw my room on the map area. As you see, the cursor asked me to select the first corner of the room. And because I've got the grid activated, as you can see in the grid buttons down here, and snap activated, that means my cursor always moves to the snap points, which are on the grid intersections as well in the middle of each square. So, see, I can draw the room here. Let's do it 30 feet wide. Seeing the grid allows me to judge that by eye very easily. Each grid is 5 feet, so 6 squares is 30 feet. Down 5 squares for 25 feet. And there's my main room. Quick refresh of the screen shows me the sheet effects on the walls. So next up, I think I'm gonna need some side rooms, and as I want to connect them with small corridors, I'm gonna draw them a little bit away from the main room. Oops, a small one here. And then I'm gonna connect these by corridors. For that, I've got the corridor tool up on the left toolbar. And this is very similar to the room dialog, just with a few options more, like we've got a corridor width. 5 feet to the corridor is fine. The background, I could choose a different floor or a wall texture for the corridors, but I'm gonna stick to the same one. And here I don't want an end wall because I'm just connecting the existing rooms. For that, I'm gonna have a couple options available. As the cursor tells me, that I can press B to connect to an existing wall and break it at the same time, meaning I get a opening for the door in there. And C is connecting to a wall without a break. For example, if I want to put in the door later or do a secret door or something. I show you the difference up here on the left, and I'm going to zoom in a bit so we can see that better. I'm going to press B to connect to this point here. Again, the grid will ensure that it goes on that in the middle of the square exactly. And then press B to connect to the upper wall. Oh, actually, I wanted to do a C actually, but I can do that on the next corridor. Let's just do this again. B down here and C for the upper wall. And there you can see that there's no gap in the wall with the second corridor. Let's take a look down here. Again, break in that bit, and no break in the lower part. Then a corridor where the stairs connects to the main floor. It's actually I think I'll prefer a gap there, so I'm just going to undo that. And now I managed to actually not complete the corridor. And there we go. And I'm also going to show you how you do corners and corridors and more irregular stuff. Let's do another room first. I want to add a couple more rooms, a bit more off to the side. One down here and one up here. And corridor. Gonna not break a gap in the wall here. I want to add a door later. And I can just here, turn right, and connect to the door, to the room wall down here. And up here, I'm going to connect to the corridor wall. You can do that just as well as to a room wall. So I'm going to do B to break, and another one here, the break up there. And you can see you've got the intersection, the junction in the corridor. just as if you've had broken a gap into the room wall. And there's our nice little dungeon layout to start with. Just the basic shape of rooms and corridors, and we're gonna edit that in a second. Let's have a quick look at the Facebook chat first, whether we've got any questions, anything I can answer. Okay, this is a question. Can you draw rooms at an angle? And yes, that's perfectly possible. Let's do another quick room here. And you can just put in a angled room like this. You don't need to adhere to the 90 degrees directions or the grid. You can draw this any type you want. And if you want to draw something a little more irregular, you don't need to do rectangles, as I've done here all the time. You can also just, if you choose the right tool, that is the rectangular room. No, not the rectangular room. I wanted to actually do a polygonal room. There we go. See, you can draw very complicated room shapes if you want to. But this is where I want to add a cave later, so I'll just delete this again for the moment. And I was talking about the cave. So I'm thinking there might be a natural cave further to the right, and something has broken through a wall somewhere, or when they built a room, they happened to open the natural cave. So I'm going to put in a cave here. I've got a cave drawing tool, and I just use the default one by left-clicking on that. And now I can start drawing a cave shape up here. I might turn off snap here, just click on the snap button down here, so I'm not, with the natural shape, not limited to the snap points. And this way I'm going to draw my cave shape. It's got a fractalize function included, that means it puts a few points, nodes, between each point I click. So I don't need to click too often here. And say it connects to this corner here. I'm just I'll just draw across over the existing floor. There's my cave shape. See that I've included a wall like for the rooms here, but you'll see that I'm going to be cleaning this up a bit and changing stuff around to make that look a little bit nicer. First thing, you'll see that we've got this wrong intersection here. The walls are just overlapping each other and generally looks wrong. So we need to actually break the section here into the walls. And for that, I'm going to use sheets a bit and the break tool. And to show that, I'm going to open up the sheets and effects dialog again. So you see, I'm working work on the walls, and I don't want to bother with the floors here at the moment. And that way, I'm just going to hide the floor sheet for the moment. Just activate the wall sheet here, and those are hidden, and I can't edit them now. And makes it much easier to work with the walls here. With the walls, I want to break a section into both the room wall and the cave wall, and we've got on the left toolbar we got the break command for that. I'm just going to click the break icon, select the wall from the room, and select my points where the break's going to be. Break starts at the point here, and the break ends at this point. And now I've done something wrong, and actually, what did I do there? Let's have a look. The floors are actually there. Didn't I? Because I was still using the commands, the program switched back to the floors on me and unhid the sheet. And that's why what I wanted to avoid happened. Here we go, let's have a look whether we can do that better. Break. Wall. Second point of wall. And there we go. That's how it's gonna suppose how it was supposed to be. See, we've got the break in the room wall. And now I'm gonna go for the cave wall. Same thing. Select the entity. And important is that you select the entity outside of the break. If I selected the entity here in the middle, where I want the break to be, then the C3 Plus would think I wanted to break the other direction and remove all the rest of the entity instead of the bit here, which I wanted to remove. Important to remember, this point you select when breaking stuff is the stuff that's going to stay around. There we go. And that looks pretty good. Got a nice break in the walls here. And we've got the div2 textures here. Now I'm thinking that I perhaps might want to expand the cave texture a little bit into the room. Basically, the dust and debris of the cave has spilled into the room. And for that, I'm just going to choose the cave tool, the floor tool here, the matching fill style. And then I'm gonna press E to edit the existing floor. Right click to finish, connect to this point, and there you see the texture is a bit further into the room. Looking good. And while I'm at it here, I'm going to add a few rocks and stones that have rests of the broken wall. For that, I'm going to go up to the symbols in the catalogs toolbar and choose the cave option. I get the catalog settings to choose from. That's basically because an annual added a second set of cave symbols at some point, and these are in two different catalogs. So I'm going to choose the default one here. And actually, that was the one that was already open. That's why you don't see a difference. So I'm just going to scroll down in the list, and I've got some rocks here. Gray seems to be the color of choice for this dungeon, so I'm going to go for the gray rocks and going to place them here. Just a little something. If I place this rock, you'll see that it will cast quite a long shadow because we are on the symbol sheet. And that's, since it's just a few small rocks on the floor, I don't want this symbol to cast such a long shadow. So I'm going to undo that and I'm going to switch to a different symbol sheet. I'm going to choose symbols flat, actually. And then place the symbols down. And there's my symbols on the floor. I've got a bigger rock here. This will actually probably still cast a shadow. So I'm going to symbols low for that. And place this here in the middle. See, there's a little shadow on this symbol. All right, that's the gap where the dungeon leads into the cave area. But one thing still is bothering me a little. I don't like the wall so much on this cave. You see, a cave would obviously not have a man-made wall, and it wouldn't. This looks like a man-made wall. So we've got a tool to change this, and because this is the wall mask in our lingo, and that's because it masks part of the wall for the effect. So I'm gonna right-click the default tool and scroll down a bit, and you see here's my wall mask. The default one basically uses the same texture I've already been using. I can also make sure that I've got, if I use a different texture, that I'm always using the one that's currently selected. So let's do that. Click the current fill style version of the tool, and then we have to adjust the fill style. Let's get the dialog here to the one we've been using for the background. And if you remember, that was Natural Stone 4, which we chose. Where's my Natural Stone? There we go. That's the texture. Okay, and this is a drawing tool where you need to trace an existing entity, the wall to be exact. So I'm going to click a first point here on the edge of the map. And then, as the command tells me, press T to trace the outline of another entity. And so I'm going to press T, get a pick cursor, and I'm going to choose the entity I want to trace, which is the wall. Then I start, then I click the point where I want to trace the, start tracing the map. And then I'm just going to follow the entity until the end here. And then I'm gonna draw it roughly parallel on the outside. And there you see our wall mask. And what happens is the wall mask basically hides half of the wall, which means that it leaves the edge, the dark shadow, and the bit of the bevel that's on the wall, and makes it look much more like the wall's been dug, or the cave's been dug into the surrounding rock. You can clean this little bit up a bit up here. This leads is a bit too far. Let's do a delete node. Or actually, what we should do instead is an edit again. So let's go back to our wall mask tool. That's way too far. Wall, there's no more. Wall mask. Edit this bit here from here. Click and right click to here. Basically cutting off this little edge that's a bit too far into the room. And there's our wall mask. Gonna do the same thing for the rest of the walls. Again, I'm gonna do T. What I need to do first is I need to click a first point, and it helps if I turn on snap here, because that makes me hit exactly the spot. And then I can trace the wall T. When tracing, it's important that and you select the entity you want to trace, click somewhere where you want the trace to go along. Otherwise, the trace will follow in the wrong direction of the entity, go in the wrong direction on the entity. There we go. Following the wall all the way to the end. And redraw the outside, and now I accidentally had the wrong fill style when I was drawing this. I went back to the solid fill style. So what we're going to do, we're just going to edit this entity by using change properties. I'm going to click this change properties button, left click the entity I want to edit, choose D for do it, and then I'm gonna change the fill style to Natural Stone 4. Okay, there we go. Quick and easy. This time I'm gonna, for the final wall, I'm gonna do it first. And there's my wall mask down here, current fill style. Click here, trace the wall. For follow the wall to the end, right click to finish, and there's my wall mask on the last bit of K-fall. We can see we went a bit too far here into the shadow. We can do little edits like this again. I could use the edit tool, but this is just a single node, one corner that is too far in here. For that, I can also choose node edit. Just grab this little node here, node, and move it to the right. Perhaps this one as well, but there we go. Much better. Another thing I can do is add columns to the cave by right-clicking the cave tool and choosing the cave wall style. Again, using the current fill style, which is our stone natural stone texture, and just draw a cave pillar into here, and it will nicely match the rest of the walls. Another one up here. There's my cave section. See, I wanted to show you how to give a bit more variation to the floor texture in the cave. It looks perhaps a bit too regular here. So we might want to go into the floor tools and choose one of the interrupted fill styles, like this one here. Let's go for the darkest. And you can use that to add dusty stony areas to the dungeon floor. To give the whole thing a little bit more variety on the floor. Another thing you might want to do, perhaps add some water area. Perhaps we've got an underground flooded tunnels or an underground lake or something. Let's just choose the water tool. Let's start drawing the water. You can also use the trace tool for this to draw water along the walls of the cave. And there we've got a little flooded section in our cave. That looks like a great place to start adventuring to go deeper into the caverns under the town or the city we started with. So let's take another quick look at questions, but I'm not seeing anything. So looks like you're just following along, which is good for me and don't have to come up with any quick explanations and stuff. And I'm just gonna continue and going back to the dungeon part of the map. See, we've got just the bare bones layout here, and for example, where we would enter our dungeon, we need a stairway that comes down from the top. So I'm going to the symbol catalogs toolbar up here and click the up and down catalog, and we've got a variety of stairs. It's the up stairs going up we have, and I'm gonna turn on snap again so it fits the corridor correctly. See it goes behind the walls automatically, and we've got the nice stairway going up. One thing I was thinking about is the walls. You see these little breaks here in there, this kind of strange effect in the texture that comes from because the bevel effect on the wall, and which is very similar to the background colors, and the sheet effects sometimes cause this little flex on the walls. And to reduce that a bit, we can reduce the size of the bevel, which might look nicer on the walls anyway. So I'm going to go to the walls sheet here and check the effects that we have. And there's a bevel on the wall. Use edit and a foot length for the bevel on a half a foot wall, which I'm using is really too much. So because we can't see the whole thing. So I'm just going to go with quarter of a foot instead. See, still got some of the little dots in here, which are nice, which are okay for now, because it's going to be a rough wall anyway. There were ways to avoid these completely, but I'm not going to go into that in this video. You see that the wall looks better this way, with an actual visible bevel on the edge and a flat part in the middle of the wall. Then we do need some doors. I've got some sections that obviously need doors. Load the wall features catalog, and we've got some nice doors here. Going to have a heavy door here to the further part or section of the dungeon. To choose a stone door. You can see it's 5 foot wide, covering a whole corridor. That's actually a bit large for a typical door. So I'm gonna right click and choose a different scale. Let's just do 75 or 3/4 of 5 feet, which would be 3.75 or something like that. And it's still gonna break a gap into the wall, as you can see here, but we'll leave the nice little section at the edges and make the door look very natural there in the place. For the other pieces, we'll need to use some wooden doors that work exactly the same way. Go. And for this door here, we could actually do a portcullis piece, which is a bit large for... Do we have a smaller one? No, we only have this one, which is probably 10 feet, so we'll just use half of that to make it fit the corridor width. There we go. So, imagining this is a crypt of some sort, it will probably have some large pillars supporting the roof. I'm going to choose the temples and statues. Catalog, choose the simple pillar. Set my size back to normal by right-clicking and then choosing set normal. More. Actually, we could even make this a bit larger. So let's say we've got really massive double-sized pillars in here, which also nicely cover a whole square. So is that a bit too much? That's a bit too much for my taste. So let's do 1.5. And there's my pillars. Of course, what's a crypt without some nice sarcophagi or coffins? Big sarcophagus. This is obviously now too large because we're still at the 1.5 scale. Let's set it back to normal. I'm using the arrow keys to orient the sarcophagus in the direction I want. One here. And now I'm going... the grid is too large to let me exactly place the symbol where I want it to go. So I'm going to turn off the snap and add some sarcophagi. One up here on the wall is nice. There's my crypt. then I might want a storeroom of some type. We've got, oh, this will be the furniture catalog, but I wanted to go to the containers and treasure catalog. Let's put some large barrels into this one here. Can stack barrels by just putting the symbols on top of each other. A small one standing. Big chest. Empty bucket. And a smaller chest here. Probably got some nice treasure in it. And this, well, what could this be? Probably, perhaps a cell to punish some errant acolytes. Okay. Let's see whether we've got any, we've got a cage. Ooh, we've got a monster spider here. Let's put some a bit of a sinister Iron Maiden in here. Okay. Okay. I just seen that we got a question here about a semicircular alcove or something like that to the rooms, which is, might actually be something nice to show. Let's do that here. At the bottom. What I would do for that is simply draw a room, a floor extension for that. Let's choose the floor drawing tool, our default floor. Oh no, actually, that's not. I didn't want to go through the drawing tool. I want to draw a cat entity, a circle for that. So I'm going to choose my settings for the floor by using the extract properties command on the floor. See, we've got the stone paving gray here selected. We are on the background floor one and in the sheet floors, which is correct. So I'm just going to choose the circle. Turn on snap and draw the circular thing first, and we'll just do a very simple one here. Let's keep it simple. I'm just gonna add some nodes to the wall. I'm just gonna choose the add node command down here on the left, or insert node, and I'm gonna work on the walls layer, and I'm gonna freeze everything else because I don't want to edit the floor now. And then I'm gonna add points, one down here, one down here, one here. So I've got the main points for my semicircle, and now I'm gonna add more points here on the wall, and I'm gonna use the on modifier. This is down here to put the points on the actual semicircle. And I can also use simply the shortcut F9 for the on modifier, which is simpler and easier. I just need to remember to actually repeat the command. And there's my little alcove. Semicircular, looks good enough for me. You could also break a gap into the wall and draw an actual semicircular section with one of the commands. Apply the same style as the wall so that you have a perfectly semi-circular wall. But this is good enough for me. I can also do something like perhaps do a bit of a raised section of wall here instead. For that, we've got another sheet, floors raised. And now I'm going to choose the default floor tool. Let's put it here in the middle. And then I'm going to trace the existing piece. Oh, actually, no, that didn't come out as I wanted it to. I would probably have to look a little more into that. The raised floor is probably set up for larger sections, and you can't really see it very well in this small section. You can see a bit of it, but let's keep it like this for now. Let's put in perhaps another little secret room. Put an altar here, or perhaps an idol. Perhaps this cult is, this temple is facade for some evil chaos cult or something. Let's increase the size of the symbol. Yeah, if you're not don't want to put in numeric scaling like I did before, want to visually scale it, you can just hold down the control button while the control key, and then move the mouse up and down, and you'll scale the symbol as you go along. You can also hold down Shift to rotate it in 15 degrees angles, on Shift and Control for a free rotate. And the arrow keys for the four cardinal directions. Go, then we've got the magic and elemental catalog, which has stuff like burning braziers, which are always good to have in a temple. It a bit. And we've got a nice pentagram which we can put on the floor in front of the statue. And for that, we need to remember to put it actually on the symbol's flat sheet, because this is, will obviously not cast a shadow. There we go. Looks nice. Let's, someone might be occasionally living down here, so let's choose the furniture catalog and have a cupboard here in the room. We can use the snap grid again to match that nicely against the wall. Desk, the other wall, down here in the corner, a chair to put in front of the desk, turn off snap again for free placement, and a bed, the lower back part of the room. And here we do have another section that needs a wall. Again, let's make that a bit smaller. There's the door on the wall. And here we've got some, perhaps something bad comes in here from the caves, or has made its lair here. Perhaps people could be coming from the other side, following a monster or something. Put in a bone pile and some other debris here. And we did have that nice little monster in the. Oh, let's. Oh, corpse is always good to find for adventurers. So let's put that here. And which will fit nicely to the ugly little thing which we'll put on the symbol's low sheet, which might, okay, it's perhaps a bit gruesome, but perhaps it's just starting to feast. Yes, Curtis, thank you. Something sinister, and I think this so-called spider bear, is sinister enough, isn't it? Hope so. Yes, and see, that's how we can create a dungeon and a cave along with that. Got some cave, some traps here, so let's put certainly not an area you want anyone to go. Let's put nice trap pit in front of the door. And perhaps you want to print a version for where the trap is not immediately visible, so you can hide the traps layer and it's going to be not visible. I want to show it again here. Okay. So perhaps for completeness sake, we can put in a scale bar. We've got some stuff here for that. That's a scale bar. Scale bars are by default 100 feet. If I set to normal, you can see this will be 100 feet. Oh, actually, no, that's not right here for the that's wrong for the dungeon here. That's actually 50 feet. It's a 50 feet toolbar, if I see that correctly. Yes, 50 feet. So well, it's a bit too large to put on the map. So let's make that half that, 25 feet. And if I place this down here, I can put in the size I want to put on the scale bar. So this is 25 feet. You can see the scale bar shows our distance. Let's add a compass rose buff. And we can also add a map title. Under the Temple of Isis. Oh, that's obviously too large. Yeah, I had increased the size of the symbol quite significantly, so let's just scale this, or just use move scale rotate the command. Click that. For text, you always need to click on the baseline of the text to select it. D for do it. Choose a point from where to move it. Oh, but I actually grabbed part of the wall mask there with the... As you can see that under the text. I accidentally selected the wall mask, so I'm just going to escape for cancel. Do the whole thing again. Go here on the outside where I don't by accident click another piece of the map. There we go. That's much better. Scale this. Put the text up here. And that's looking nice. Okay, we've got another question from Sue. Do the traps automatically end up on the traps layer? Not directly, but when you click one of the catalogs up here in the catalog toolbar, they are set to set a default layer for that. So if I click on doors, you can see the layer changes to wall features. Or if I click on traps, it changes to the traps layer. That leads to mostly automatically placing the traps on the relevant layer, but you can always change that if you want to add something else somewhere. Fire blast, and instead of traps I want it on the game master only layer. I can choose that afterwards and say this statue can breathe fire on some unlucky adventurers. There's my fire blast on the shadow casting sheet, which is not really where it should go. So let's do move to sheet command. You can access that by right clicking the sheets button here on the left toolbar. Select the edge of the symbol. Do it. And let's put it on the symbols vaults sheet. There we go. That's our fire blast. Okay, and with that, we've covered most of the stuff you need for a basic dungeon with a cave, and we've got almost an hour done in our mapping, so I think it's a good point to stop. Any more questions? Not at the moment. You've been a quiet audience today. Hope you still enjoy the map making, and hope to see you again next week. Bye-bye.